Hello everyone, thank you very much firstly for your patience and thank you also for joining us this afternoon for this panel discussion either in person or through the live stream. I'm Naomi Polonsky, I'm the Assistant Curator here at Newhall Art Collection and co-curator of Maud Sulter, the Centre of the Frame, along with Harriet Loeffler. For those of you who don't know it, the Newhall Art Collection is a collection of modern and contemporary art by women at Murray Edwards College. It was founded in the early 1990s in order to challenge the underrepresentation of women artists in museums and galleries, and is now the largest collection of its kind in Europe. Maud Sulter was one of the first artists to donate work to the collection and was a key figure in its early history. And it's long been our ambition to bring together the works in her incredible Zabat series and to highlight her beautiful and important art. Sulter hasn't been as recognised as she deserves to be, but there's a lot of interest and energy surrounding her work now, and it's very exciting to be a part of that. I want to thank all of the lenders who generously loaned their work for this exhibition and its tour to Touchstone Rochdale, which is the gallery that initially commissioned this series. And I also want to thank Deborah Cherry, who manages Maud Sulter's estate, for all her help and guidance during the process of curating it. One of the things that we wanted to emphasise in curating this exhibition and organising this panel discussion was to show the multifaceted nature of Maud Sulter's practice. She was a visual artist, but also a poet, a curator, an editor, a dramatist, a sound artist, an activist. The list goes on. She was a real Renaissance woman. And we're really pleased that tonight's panel brings together people who knew her in various different contexts and have different perspectives on her work. Those who knew her personally and collaborated with her, those who have researched her work from an academic and curatorial point of view, and those who have been influenced by her artistically. So thank you so much to Jelaine, Dion, Marcia, Laura and Evan for taking part. And finally, I want to thank our brilliant partners on this event, the Paul Mellon Centre. It absolutely wouldn't have been able to happen without you, and it was such a joy to work on this together.
Thanks, Naomi. Hi, everyone. I'm Sarah Turner. I'm the Deputy Director at the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And I just wanted to say a few words of welcome and thanks on behalf of the Paul Mellon Centre. For those of you who don't know about the centre, we're an educational charity and a research centre. We're based in central London and a part of Yale University. And our role is to support research on the histories of British art and architecture. And our mission is to open up those histories and to re-examine them and to provide access and to support for the study, research and learning about art and art history. And one of the ways we do that is by collaborating on events such as this one, which bring people together to share ideas. And Maud Sulter was an artist and a thinker who was deeply invested in what she described in one of her texts as the call and response of making, exhibiting, displaying, writing and debating about art's role in the world and about making histories visible. And this display, organised by the curators of the Newhall Art Collection, offers us a moment of gathering and reflection. And I really want to thank Naomi Polonsky and the team, all the team, and especially the tech team at Murray Edwards for making today's event happen. And the Paul Mellon Centre's events manager, Shauna Blanchfield, for all her work on planning the logistics of holding a live hybrid event. And just for your, that wait at the beginning shows that this is some new territory for us as we test out the technology. And we really want to welcome those of you who are here in person with us. It's absolutely brilliant to have so many people in a room together. And to those of you who are watching virtually, again, welcome to you. Thank you for your support. Thank you for joining us. And we hope that you'll join by posing questions in the Q&A session as well. We can take questions from in the room and from outside the room. So do join in with the conversation today. Now I want to introduce our chair to you, Jelaine Tradros, who will be chairing the panel discussion for the rest of the afternoon. As many of you will know, she's the chief executive of DAX, a not-for-profit visual arts rights management organisation, and is the co-director of the Arts 360 Foundation, which she established in 2016 with Mark Waugh. She's got many other accolades, but like all our speakers today, their biographies are also on our events page. So you can read about their amazing careers and what they do by having a look at that. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Ghislaine and say thank you to you and all our panel and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.
Hi, welcome everybody, and thank you Naomi and Sarah for convening this very special conversation today on Maud Sulter. I'd also like to thank Sean and the brilliant tech team here at Murray Edwards College who've done such a fabulous job. It's wonderful to see Maud Sulter's Zabat out. We were just talking earlier, some of us haven't seen that work for 3 decades. And I've been very excited to see the resurgence of interest and engagement with Maud's work in recent years. And I'd like to pay tribute to the estate of Maud Sulter, but also to all the artists, curators, and art historians who've kept the fire lit, championing Maud's work and, and her significance as an artist, writer, curator, poet, and so many other things, as Naomi said. The history of art, as we know, is full of absences, and it requires persistence and effort to ensure that artists of colour and women artists in particular are part of our shared cultural history and memory. And if you haven't already done so, I urge you all to go and see the wonderful exhibition, Lumen, by another important artist, Shitupa Biswas, who's with us here today, which is at Kettle's Yard. It's a really fabulous show. One of the reasons that Maud Sulter speaks so powerfully and eloquently to new generations of artists, curators, and audiences is, I think, because she was so far ahead of her time in addressing the absences and elisions in our shared culture, and in particular, the glaring absence of Black women from regimes of representation in the historical record. Maud spoke about how she was fascinated, even haunted, by the idea of disappearance and the disappeared. And I just want to read you something that she wrote. "The whole notion of the disappeared, I think, is something that runs through my work. I'm very interested in absence and presence, in the way that particularly Black women's experience and Black women's contribution to culture is so often erased and marginalized. So that it's important for me as an individual and obviously as a Black woman artist, to put Black women back in the center of the frame, both literally within the photographic image, but also within the cultural institutions where our work operates." Although she wouldn't have expressed herself in these terms, by the late 1980s, Maud was decolonizing the discipline of art history, the archive, and the museum, making works that are complex, multi-layered, and compellingly beautiful. Works which also bring back into the central frame Black women's creativity and the histories, she would have called them her stories, and experiences of Black women. One of my earliest pieces of writing was on Maud Sulter's series called Hysteria, which she made in 1991, not long after the Zabat series that are on exhibition here. I was commissioned by Mark Seeley, director of Autograph, the Association of Black Photographers, to write a review of Hysteria. Maud had been a MoMART fellow at Tate Liverpool between 1990 and 1991, and the touring exhibition of Hysteria started at Tate Liverpool in August 1991. It was an installation made up of photographic prints, marble plaques, scripted narrative, and audio recording. And it tells the story of a 19th century Black woman artist who sails from the Americas to Europe to seek fame and fortune as a sculptor in Rome. But having achieved a successful career, she disappears. It's a fictional tale based on fragments of the true life story of Edmonia Lewis, a successful artist who lived and worked around this period. And the review I wrote was called The Case of the Disappearing Black Woman Artist. This exhibition and this afternoon's conversation continues a vital process of redressing the absences and elisions of, in art history, bringing Maud Sulter back into the centre of the frame. And I'm really delighted that we've got 4 amazing women on the panel this afternoon, and I'm very excited to hear their presentations. First of all, Laura Castagnini is a curator and writer interested in the histories of feminism and their current articulations, especially as they intersect with the politics of sexuality and race and their expression in modern contemporary art. And Laura's just been appointed as curator of the Australian Centre for the Moving Image in Melbourne, which is wonderful. Congratulations, Laura. Laura's admired Sulter's work since she was introduced to it many years ago by artists of her own generation, including Evan. As a curator, she worked on Tate's first acquisition of Maud's work, the major series Les Bijoux, which entered the collection last year. Next, we'll hear from Evan Efakoya, who is a London, UK-based artist, educator, and energy worker, who through sound, text, video, and performance, places demands on existing systems and institutions of power to recenter and prioritize the experience and voice of those previously marginalized. Evan finds great refuge in the breadth of practice that Maud has left behind, in particular the safi, a token of remembrance the viewer leaves with after viewing an artwork, has been an inspiration for their own investigations into a collectively orientated art practice. Next, we'll hear from Marcia Michael, whose multidisciplinary practice centres on the reconstruction of the Black family archive. Marcia injects current discourses of the personal that speak about and to the Black presence in Britain. Marcia does so within a Black feminist, intergenerational and decolonial visuality that pertains to her own diasporic experience and that of her ancestors. Marcia identifies with Maud as an artist who returned to search for their heritage in places of remembrance. She too has searched the same landscapes for words and memories of foremothers that keep on returning. Dion Sparks is a London-based artist whose painting practice explores abstraction and the transformation of materials to create objects of contemplation. Dion met Maud while studying on the BA Fine Art and John Moores University in the late 1980s, and Maud later invited Dion to show work in exhibitions such as Passion, Contemporary Black Women's Creativity of the African Diaspora. They also worked together for a short time as part of the Feminist Arts News Collective. Following her graduation, Maud invited Dion to model for Zabat, in which she represented Erato, the muse of lyric poetry. So without further ado, Laura. Dion, sorry, it's first up. Forgive me.
Thank you. So lovely to see you all. Good afternoon. My name is Dion Sparks, as we've just said. I'm an artist, I'm a teacher, and also, as you heard, a sitter for Zabat. I'd just like to share some brief thoughts. They're quite personal, I guess, this afternoon. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of my memories of Maud, my perspective as a sitter, and just a little bit about her legacy and her impact on myself, my work, and the wider world. And I'll start with some of my memories. And as I was invited to this panel, I started to think about what kind of, you know, words come up when I think of her. And the sorts of things that come to mind are formidable, clever, caring, legacy, history, style, prolific, multifaceted, bold, stature, inspiring, daring, commitment, sharp, wit, self-aware, ambition, strategic. And I think what I'm trying to just bring to mind there is just what a formidable, self-aware, powerful artist Maud Sulter was. And really, I've shared this with some of the panel, that when you were with her, you really had a sense that you had to raise your game. She was incredibly strategic. I think we've heard that a little bit just in the introduction. She had an incredible sense of history and her place in it. She had a lot of foresight in how to work with organisations and individuals to bring her work into the world and the work of other Black women. And in particular, Zabat is a fantastic example of that. As you know, she worked with Rochdale Gallery to create this work, and it was the 150th birth of photography. So a very timely piece of work. And as you heard, I met Maud in the late 80s, and there was a period in that time where we spent a little bit of time together. I'm just going to focus a little bit on Zabat in particular. There were a number of projects we worked on, but in Zabat, she invited me to work as to sit as a sitter, but also to work as an assistant on that project. And what I noticed when I assisted her, I just finished my degree, so it was a fantastic opportunity for me. You know, we worked in the studio. She was a great collaborator. She worked with somebody who was supporting her technically with the camera. I remember Labena Himid being there at certain points, but she had an incredible sort of clarity and vision around what she was doing. It was it had huge scope and ambition. I don't recall lots of conversation about how to, you know, what to do, how to prepare, but I do recall she asked us to bring some clothes and an object or objects that meant something to us. And actually, you're not sharing the slides, am I? I'm not sure where the clicker is. Oh, here it is, sorry. So I think we should put the slides up. So obviously you can see what we've seen in the exhibition this afternoon, the portrait here of Maud and this one here of myself. Some people, you know, I did have the mask on earlier, so it wasn't quite clear, but it is me, I promise, that is me. And you'll notice that the clothes are, those are my own, so she asked us to bring in things. And they're actually just ordinary clothes. There's nothing particularly, they're just everyday clothes, that my jewellery, the fabric that somebody gave me, a friend. And Maud gave me the drum and asked me to pose with that. And what I noticed when she was working that, you know, there was a very careful attention to detail, you know, the way that she set up the lighting, the backdrops and so on. Perhaps when we come to the panel discussion, we could talk a little bit more about the self-portrait, because I remember that I think we were alone in the studio on that day. And obviously she needed a lot of guidance or help, physical help around making that. So perhaps we can talk about that. But my reflections when I look at this work and think about this work is, you know, the challenge that she made to the role of the muse and the model. And interesting that when she selected the sitters, you know, some of them were obviously very well known, Alice Walker, an incredible public figure. But others like myself and Delta Street, we were just sort of newly graduated, not well known. But she presented us all in at the same level. So there was a certain sort of collective equality there. And I do find it quite incredible to think about and reflect on that she has somehow immortalized us. And I don't think I quite understood that at the time. But now that I recognize it's in public collections, you know, you realize that you've been put in the history books. So, you know, speaking to the omissions that we were talking about before, this is quite quite a special privilege. And also, the beauty of the images, the care, the color, the composition, the textures and the richness of those images are really powerful. And she was also very aware of how to get her work into public collections. So it was interesting to me that she donated this to this collection here, which obviously allows it to be taken care of for the future. And when I came to reread the artist's book that accompanies the exhibition, so it's about the poetics of a family tree, I found it to be an incredibly rich poetic document. You know, it reads almost like a mix of time travel, a sort of memory, a reimagining. It's a sort of historic and almost like a poetic longing. There's a lot of longing in that piece, I found. And I'll just quote from her here. She ends with this kind of cryptic message. She says, "And so we return to the end of this tale. You might be desirous of a few answers. Well, I myself have one question. What happened to the missing others? And if you don't know, why should I tell you?" So I found that a really powerful sort of cryptic Maud message. I'll just finish on a little bit on her sort of legacy and impact on my own work and myself and some of the messages I think I recall. One of the things she would say a lot is you just have to keep going. You know, as a black woman artist, you have to keep going. And actually, she said it gets harder, not easier. That's something I heard her reflect on several times, that, you know, that journey gets more challenging. But she also emphasized that you're not alone. It's that, you know, hers was not an individualistic endeavor. It was very much part of a kind of collective. So a sense that, you know, you're not the first, you know, there are people before you. There's a long history. It's that you're part of a continuum. You're part of a collective in the present, but also the future. That was a very important message that I took. But also that your particular work is very important, and that you had to value it, and that you were making a valuable contribution. And these are some works from my work at the time. It feels very old, this work now, it's 30 years ago, but it's at the same sort of period. It was actually made a bit before Zabat. But what was interesting, I think some of the parallels is, some of the parallels were about looking back or looking into the future. And also the sort of physically putting yourself centre stage. So those sort of photographic silk screens in textiles are obviously self-portraits. And currently I'm actually doing an MA painting at the Royal College of Art, and I'm returning to Zabat actually. I'm doing a piece that's about a kind of homage to that work. So it's still leaving its legacy. Maud also understood the importance of organising and networking. This was very important. And documenting. I think this, you know, she had incredible foresight to understand. These are some of the things when I looked back through my files, the sort of things I found in my archive. This exhibition that I was very honoured to take part in, that she invited me to Passion. And these are some of the documents around that. So very often, you know, there might have been exhibitions, but there was nothing physical and tangible. This is a pre-digital age. And so it's wonderful that the art historian, for example, Deborah Cherry, as people have mentioned, are able to go back to these archives and that she left us that kind of trail. And as Lubaina Himid said, I'm just quoting a little bit from Passion, which is this book that Maud edited, a very important book. I also contributed an essay here. Lubaina Himid writes here in her essay, Mapping a Decade of Black Women Artists, 1980 to 90. She writes, "It's been depressing not to have been immortalised in the coffee table book. It has forced some of us into being publishers." And clearly, Maud took up that mantle and understood the importance of documentation. We're clearly in a new moment now. I'll just leave it on that for the moment. We're clearly in a new moment. There's still a lot to do, a lot of work, but we can now enjoy major exhibitions such as the one coming up by Lubaina Himid at the Tate, or we are now being represented by Sonia Boyce at the Venice Biennale. And, you know, it's credit to those artists, and we all celebrate that and enjoy this progress. But I do feel some of the gold does rub back onto Maud, and this is part of her legacy. And actually, just a little note that she wrote to me when I graduated and I gained a first class degree, and actually she had contributed to my degree as I interviewed her and Lubaina Himid for my dissertation. And in the note she wrote, you know, congratulations, but I do recognise that some of the gold rubs back on us all. So she kind of recognised her own contribution there. And she did something extraordinary with her life, I think, and she really just kept going. That was the amazing thing. I just want to finish, I think, with a little quote from Zabat, and this is one of her greatest gifts, I think. This is a quote from Maud Sulter. "If you need to see yourself and your beauty, you can look in a mirror." Thank you, I'll end there. Thank you.
So it's really nice to be here. Can you all hear me fine? Great, it's nice to be here. Okay. I'm going to get straight stuck in. Thanks, Dion. That was just amazing. And I'm feeling the connections through what I'm about to say. So through her use of words and pictures of others as a woman who returned to search and claim her heritage, to me, Maud was a time traveller. I do believe that if she was alive today, today would never have been the today that Black artists are seeing, living and being in. Today would have happened a long time ago. As an artist, I turned to Maud for her realness and her maternal passion to use the personal to reclaim the history, making everything that is done by Black people, especially mothering, political. Over and over, she used her body and her voice to preach about the others, for others, for whom she searched for and lived because of. Her aforementioned foresight, as seen in the Black Muses she got in front of the camera, is proof of her time-travelling capabilities. And yet, it is not to her images that I turn as a photographer. It's to her writing. It's her ability to return, to remember, and to reclaim that which she knows she must. Not just a body, but a voice. In order to speak their truth into existence, I'm going to read Maud's poem from the standpoint as I am in, a Black woman. As I do so, I will acknowledge the lengths that her spirit has travelled to be able to write those words that I can speak. I will then read my own poem, Ain't I a Black Woman, written years apart, but made through a similar reclamation of place, body, and maternal yearning for our ancestral bodies. And as I read these poems, I ask you to ponder on the many ways in which her words become mine. And then I hope that my words become embedded in yours. For in speaking a language whose words were constructed in the same timeline as the oppressor's language, we, as in all of us, make ourselves time travellers. And even dare I say shapeshifters, alternating between their worlds and worlds. It is through our powerful imagination that enables the historic Black and brown bodies to give them a voice. A voice they have always had. Therefore, when we speak within our works, when I speak here now, I speak in uniform with them present with me always. I continue to speak their vocabulary, which is always in conversation with each other, because over time and time again, they tell me, they show me that they spoke to each other with love. Black love. Maud has shown me the importance of claiming their words in those places when she went to Africa and photographed the slave ports in Gambia in her series Sphinx. In my own search for my maternal ancestors, I did the same. I returned. I learnt. I embodied. I speak from their memory always. As I journeyed to Jamaica to retrieve through an embodied imagination the absences of my foremothers, Maud's wailing. Not to hear, but it's a cry
It's a cry to intercede. They beg, they yearn for an intercession for our bodies and our minds, our stories that have to be retold. I have come to understand as I gaze at black and brown faces who sit among the audience here, who sit in my heart, in my memory, in my mind, whose presence have always been here. Did you get me? They've always been here on this earth, in the mythological narratives. I sense the elements of strength, beauty, and tradition in Maud's muses. In naming her muses, there is an ancestral kinship that is formed where channels of communication are created by blood, but also in blood.
Hey! Why have I dropped on? Have I dropped on? Why? Why? What am I going to do, baby?
To be able to speak words said in their timeline through bodies that resemble my own, perhaps within Alice Walker's womanist expressions, that is to reveal and share the intergenerational strengths and relations to the ways in which women's love, culture, agency, and commitment connect and inspire to the well-being of all the people, means that I too am a time traveler. Words heard today were remembered yesterday, and words told tomorrow that hit your heart today are words that have traveled through because of love. As I read As a Black Woman by Maud Sulter, I ask you to take note of her words and then of my own. As a black woman, the bearing of my child is a political act. I have been mounted in rape, bred from like cattle, mined for my fecundity. I have been denied abortion, denied contraception, denied my freedom to choose. I have been subjected to abortion, injected with contraception, sterilized without my consent. I have borne witness to the murderers of my children by the clan, the front, the state. I have borne sons hung for rape, for looking at a white girl. I have borne daughters shot for being liberationist. As a black woman, I have taken the power to choose to bear a black child, a political act. As a black woman, every act is a political act. Every act is a political act. As a black woman, the personal is political, holds no empty rhetoric. Ain't I a black woman? No right to be angry, no right to cry, no right to hold your hand or talk to you, no right to see you or call you my own. I never had the right to call you by your name that I chose. I'm a nigger, and that means everything to your father. He treated me just like I was a slave. I was a slave. And then he got his friends to do the same. The color of my skin was betrayed by the fullness of my belly, twice. more. If I had stayed, I ran. Truth be told, if I stayed, I would have died. He would have killed me and told them that I took my own life. Does that sound familiar? But am I not dead now without you? Ain't I a woman to have feelings and a soul? Ain't I a woman that I should know my children, my kin, my life? I wish you know. I wish you could know what it means to be me. Does my life matter? Does my black life matter? Ain't I a woman? How I wish I could be free. How I wish you could be free. He tried, like the previous master, to make me feel as though I could only live my life because of him. For a moment, he was right. My mind had been twisted. He takes away my children, my child, so that I no longer feel like a woman, human, like living. And then he tells them, my children, he tells them that their black skin wears the trauma of their mother's ancestors. Yeah, you're right. Their black skin wears the trauma of my ancestors, my kinky hair, your Afro hair that I pass on to you means I've passed on other things too. Memories. Breathe. Don't forget the sky. Remember the eyes. Remembering is everything. Tell everyone who has ears to hear, to hear. Tell them in ways they will understand. Sing, write, show your body. Let them touch the history that is yours. It is yours. They want me to wait until slavery is over, but I have been to the future. I have seen what not remembering does. I have witnessed what forgetting is. I cannot wait any longer. I cannot wait until this slavery is over. It is never over. The names just change. Women, children, mothers, daughters, brothers, fathers. Have we not suffered? Have we not suffered? Have we not suffered? Our bodies, our minds traumatized. It runs in your DNA, they now tell us, lest I forget who I am. Who am I? I am your mother. I'm a woman. And my skin is black, like yours, my children. Thank you.
How to follow on from that? Well, thank you, Marcia and Dion. Honestly, yeah, I am feeling a lot of things right now. Okay, let me get myself together. Right. Whew. Wow. Yeah, I mean, thank you for this invitation. You know, to be here to talk a little bit about the huge impact that, you know, Maud Sulter has had on my practice today, and, you know, really does continue to have. And yeah, what I'm offering and sharing today is, yeah, a few reflections, a few encounters on, yeah, the way that her impact, the way that her practice has impacted the way that I work, the way that I organize, and has really played a huge part in where I am, and, you know, all that I'm able to offer to the world. And I wanted to kind of touch on a couple of the words, a couple of terms that have really stayed with me that I came to know about through work, and one of those is ka, which is a spirit of resistance, and then the safi, which is a token of remembrance that the viewer leaves with after viewing an artwork. And, you know, both of these terms are terms I would say really weave into my own practice. And yeah, I will, you know, elaborate about that as I go on. And so, you know, what you see here is a letter that I wrote as part of a project that I was involved in with a group I used to, and still do in some way, organize with, called Collective Creativity. And we were, you know, we came together around 2013, you know, having felt really failed by our arts educations in various ways. And we came together as queer, Black, and people of color to kind of, you know, kind of look at, you know, and try and address in our own way these absences, you know, and we would informally meet and just, we were trying to piece together, you know, the histories that we knew were there, but for some reason weren't visible. And I'm just going to read a little quote from a publication that we put together called Surviving Art School, An Artist of Colour Toolkit, which was in collaboration with Nottingham Contemporary around 2015 or 16. So upon discovering artists like Maud Sulter, Claudette Johnson, Shutapa Biswas, Sonia Boyce, Labena Hamid, Zarina Bimji, Chaila Kumari Berman, Ingrid Pollard, Palomi Desai, we realize that these are still the only ones that made it into books. And if you look, you will find them, but there really are many more. Knowing their work cements a sense of history, of knowing that there were artists in the 80s at the height of race politics making subversive critical work about identity. You have a legacy that is yours, that you can refer to. It's more than representation. It's seeing people who reflect your own story in those big glossy art books, people who have names like yours. It gives a sense of connection rather than a sense of constant loss and mourning, which is what living in a neo-colonial, heteropatriarchal world feels like. And, you know, one of the things that we did as part of this project was we held a workshop, and one of the activities was to write a letter to a future younger self. And what you can see here is the letter that I wrote as part of that activity. I'm going to read it now. A letter to a future younger self. Dear Evan, I'm writing this to let you know about a book I wish I'd known about when I was studying at Winchester. It's called Passion, Discourses on Black Women's Creativity. I think if you'd known about it then, you wouldn't have felt so lonely. You would, in a sense, because you would have still been surrounded by middle-class whiteness, but at least you would have known the artists with passion, energy, and drive who were coming from a similar place as you existed. You would have learned about the amazing work of artists such as Labena Hamid and Ingrid Pollard. You were already aware of Maud Sulter because of the Circus series, but you didn't know about the movement they had created, the pivotal bringing together and organizing of Black female artists' work. It would have helped you to hear about their struggles and persistence, and it will help you to keep going when you feel like you can't anymore. With love, Evan, a future you. And then, you know, shortly after this, I also went on to, you know, really write about Maud and some of her work as part of my MA thesis paper. This was around 2015. And again, I'm kind of, you know, reflecting on an encounter with Passion. Because at that time, you know, I was finding it very hard to find a copy. I mean, thankfully, I do have one now, but at that time, it was proving tricky. And this thesis was actually kind of, I guess, in a similar way to the Thin Black Lines book that you know, the exhibition catalogue that went with the exhibition. I wrote it as like a series of letters. So I'm writing to this figure, Abiola. You know, I've been trying to find a copy of Passion, discourses on Black women's creativity to send you. It's proving challenging. The book, first published in 1990, is out of print and not widely stocked in art libraries across the country. To me, it's just as crucial a text as ways of seeing or mythologies. What do we do when the books we need to read are not in our libraries? How do we find them? And how do they find us? You know, and it's in passion that I first read poems from Zabat, Poetics of a Family Tree, which was Maud's second volume of poetry, published in 1989. And it was, you know, through that text that I came to know about this term, car, you know, and I'm going to read just a short extract from the poem Full Circle, where you start to kind of, where this car, the essence of it starts to reveal itself. Whatever fragment you find, preserve, recognize yourself, heritage, responsibility, worth, more precious than gold weights, the spirit of car. And then another extract from my thesis paper. Car, the spirit of resistance, permeates the following text. Car is a term I came to learn of through the work of Lubaina Hamid and Maud Sulter. In the catalogue for the exhibition, New Robes for Marshulan by Lubaina Hamid, Maud Sulter writes that the artwork would often come back devoid of small pieces of card or wool or drawing pins. Never vandalised, just depleted. It's nice to think that Black people take small tokens as saffis, tokens of remembrance. So Sulter takes the gesture enacted by the viewer as an act of solidarity, friendship even, a sign that the work is made to be shared as a collective endeavour. And across a prolific output of collaborative exhibitions, magazine articles and catalogue essays, the relationship between the pair of artists is made visible. The traces of friendship that I find encouraging in my own pursuit of a de-individualising art practice. Is there something specific in an artwork made between and for friends, distinct from the increasingly market-driven archetypal subject-object orientation that is very common, you know, to art making these days? There had not previously existed spaces for Black women to show their art on their own terms. So writing in a different time, 2015, now 2021, I wonder what we should take from these practices, what we should carry with us moving forward, and what we need to do differently. So since working with collective creativity, which was very much about, you know, redressing the imbalance within our own relationship to art history, you know, I've gone on to be part of a number of other different collectives. And, you know, more recently in 2018, I went on to establish Black Obsidian Sound System with a number of peers working in art, film and sound. And, you know, similarly in the way that, you know, Maud worked and, you know, collaborated with her peers, you know, it was a marginal status that brought us together. And in our individual togetherness, we have everything we need. We become abundant. And, you know, with Boss, the sound system is our sacred object, our totem, a symbol of our collective struggles and desire for more. And the itinerant nature of the system means that we can transform any space into one where we can feel a sense of belonging. And I'm going to return to the essence of car, this time with an extract from Historical Objects, again in Zabat, Poetics of a Family Tree. Slavery days. And here I find you still on the plantation, now differently guised, yet still a bondage. And freedom, freedom has an empty call when I see you still chained to their supremacist belief in themselves. They cannot be allowed any longer to rewrite our experience. Call it Marxist or feminist, history or herstory, no longer, no more. Car is rising, car is rising. Listen, listen, you can hear her call. for car is rising, car is rising, here come here, her call. And, you know, I really wanted to understand, you know, where this word car originates. And, you know, I've since come to learn that it is an ancient Kemetian term, now known as Egypt. And yeah, it's this idea of a universal spirit, you know, that resides in each and every one of us. And in the hieroglyphic symbol, it's represented as a pair of open arms held upwards. You know, it's the inner consciousness that is at the root of our power. You know, and I've been really galvanized by this idea of a spirit of Ka within my own practice. You know, and it's something that I do draw great inspiration from. And, you know, and I can see how that spirit, that energy really does permeate the Zabat series, you know, the photographic series that we are here and is being exhibited, you know, currently at this moment. And, you know, it was really a great honor and a privilege to be able to see, you know, the whole series in the flesh for, you know, the first time. And it was I was able to really kind of transform my experience and my understanding of those works by actually seeing them in the flesh. And, you know, I'm also really interested in, you know, the images, of course, but also the text, you know, that Maud wrote about these works, you know, because a Zabat is a sacred dance. It's an occasion of power and it's a Black woman's rite of passage. You know, and these words and the images, you know, call to mind for me, as, you know, has been talked about, you know, the importance of seeing oneself as part of something greater, as part of a lineage, as part of an ancestry. And, you know, also, you know, for me also, there's something in the works and in, you know, in that decision, I think, to kind of draw from the muse, you know, the kind of the mythology that we are so familiar with. But it's a familiarity that, you know, at least for me, I kind of always saw as like outside of me, you know, and somehow there's this kind of renegotiation of where I can sit within a frame. And, you know, the polyima, the portrait of Dr. Yusei Barnwell was a work that today I spent a lot of time with. Because, you know, I could really see her in me, you know, the wide face, the dark skin. And in that moment, I felt powerful. You know, I felt a sense of belonging. And, you know, that really does... Yeah, I mean, I don't have words for it, you know, I really don't, but there's just something really, really special about that, and that kind of encounter that one can have with an artwork, you know, that isn't the way of, you know, it isn't this intellectualizing of it, but just really accounts for the affect, you know, the embodied experience that one can have when one engages and interacts with a work. You know, and I actually just wanted to end with a quote that I found by Maud as she was reflecting, you know, on this series. Compared to the composition of the stars, a photograph is no big deal. Any fixation of evidence or providence or the like is but nothing compared to the fact that we can take flight through the heavens and visit each other just when we like. And for me, that really kind of speaks to something actually Marcia said, you know, around time travel. And, you know, Maud very much was, and in some way very much still is, a time traveler. And again, that's something that really, yeah, I draw a lot of strength from in my own practice. So yeah, that's it for me.
Can you hear me okay? No. Is that better? I haven't done an in-person thing for such a long time. I don't know how to do anything. Yeah, I just wanted to start by saying thank you for having me here. What an amazing lineup. It feels like a real honor to be part of. And yeah, I'm going to do a sort of overview or sort of art historical perspective to contextualize some of the work. I'm going to speak specifically about this work, Calliope, which you would have seen in the exhibition, which is a self-portrait of Maud as Jeanne d'Arc. Maud, sorry, I'm a bit nervous. Here we go. Jeanne d'Arc haunted Maud's practice for over a decade. As she says here, her ongoing visual fascination with Jeanne d'Arc began in 1988 with the response to the Nadar photograph captioned Unknown Woman. There she stared at me, willing me to give her a name, an identity, a voice. So for over a decade, I've been image making with her in mind, from Calliope in Zabat to Le Bijou in 2002. Oops. So Jeanne d'Arc was the little known romantic companion and muse of Baudelaire, the French poet. And she was born in Haiti with a date that was unknown. And she was an actress and dancer of mixed French and African ancestry. She was reportedly the granddaughter of an enslaved woman from Guinea in West Africa, sent by her owners to France to work in a brothel. She met the young Baudelaire in 1942 when she was part of a sort of amateur dance performance. And she was with him for 25 years. That relationship has been considered the most important in his life. And she was a muse for a lot of his work. In particular, she was a muse in a very sort of exoticized way. She was his Black Venus. And in particular, we'll come to that a little bit later in this talk. I think what's interesting about the way that Maud brings Jeanne d'Arc in is it's through a sort of haunting of herself. So she's embodying Jeanne d'Arc in this work in particular. As you can see, she's even got the sort of the robe as well, but has a very different expression looking away from the camera, and also having the camera on the table in front of her. So I wanted to show you some of the images that she makes after Calliope, who, as you would have seen, was the muse of poetry. And as you would have seen, there was 9 different muses in all the different... I can hear myself. Okay, yeah, thanks. So this is... Jeanne d'Arc, the original Nadar photograph. Actually, I should maybe speak a little bit about that photograph. As you would have seen, it was it's been titled Unknown Woman, and it's debated whether it was indeed actually Jeanne d'Arc. There are images of Jeanne d'Arc which are doodles from Baudelaire, but this is something that when Maud found this image, she was really captivated by, and in particular, she was captivated by this sense of sort of what the image can do. I might read this quote from her that I really like. She says, quote, "Who is this Jeanne d'Arc? A beautiful Black woman who inspired Baudelaire to write some of the finest poetry and prose poems ever written. Miracles of language which explore her sensuality, sexuality, and ethnicity, observed by the poet as the Western world stood on the cusp of modernity itself. And therein lies the crisis point for the vast contradictions in how she is perceived and portrayed." And I think that idea of the crisis point in the history of photography is something that Maud's work looks at again. And she said at one point that photography is not a tool, it's a weapon. And I think, that sort of comes back again and again. This is a work that she made in 1994, which are these really small collages, which are actually collaged directly onto the back of a book about Manet. So it's sort of an act of graffiti, as well as inserting Jeanne d'Arc into these images. And then the last work that she made was this major work called Le Bijou, which is now on, three of the works are now on display at Tate Britain in the 60 years exhibition. And in a way, I think that she takes what she does in Calliope and expands it out into this much bigger exploration of who Jeanne d'Arval is. The title, Les Bijoux, is, relates to a poem by Baudelaire, which he writes, "My beloved was naked and, knowing my heart's desire, had kept only her sonorous jewels on, whose rich splendor gave her the triumphant air that Moorish slave women have on their happy days." So rather than depicting Jeanne d'Arval naked with only her jewels on, Maud is representing her with an array of different emotions, with a subjectivity, and also she's very much clothed and in control. I think the other thing to mention about this work is, actually, I'll talk a little bit about the format. So these are Polaroids. They were made with the giant Polaroid, the 20 by 24, which is the biggest Polaroid camera in the world. There's only 7 of these in existence. They weigh over 100 kilograms. And this one was owned by the Czech photographer Jan Hisno, who traveled with it from Czech Republic to Sulter studio in Edinburgh. And it was sort of interesting working on the acquisition of this work for Tate. Because they are Polaroids, they're really light sensitive, and they can only be shown for 1 month every year, which means that if you most displays are about 6 months. So if you show the work for at one of the Tate sites for one exhibition, it's out of action for 6 years, which it's very... I don't know, I think thinking about this idea of disappearance and the fragility of the photograph, but also Black women's history, I think it's almost sort of ironic that this work is so difficult to display and to store and to keep. But the other thing that's sort of interesting about this work is that way that she moves, and I'm going to quote here Deborah Cherry, who's argued that there is a clear shift in focus from the trajectory of Sulter's engagement with the subject of Jeanne d'Arval. She says, "By this point, the exhilaration and animation of Zabat has vanished. D'Arval is silent, unspeaking, mute." And Sulter herself has talked about this. So in the catalogue, she says, "I reconfigure myself as Jeanne d'Arval, not as previously in Zabat, as an active muse and artist, but in a funk of post-musedom." And so the work then led to this major group exhibition that Maud put on at the National Gallery Scotland in Edinburgh, in which she presented her own work of herself as Jeanne d'Arval, with possible appearances of Jeanne d'Arval throughout history. So she loaned works by Manet and Courbet. This is in 2003 at the National Gallery. And surprisingly, I haven't been able to find that much information about this, this exhibition, considering, I don't know, I find it a really exciting sort of huge undertaking. And for it to, yeah. But obviously this subject has been looked at in the Black Models exhibition that was in Paris a couple of years ago. So I think, anyway, that's sort of future research. I just wanted to also mention where I'm sort of going next with this. I'm really interested in thinking about of Maud's practice. D'Arval was apparently bisexual, according to the Who's Who in Gay and Lesbian History. And I've started reading Nella Hopkinson's The Salt Roads, which I'm not sure if anyone else on the panel has read, but it's so beautiful. And so it's talking about, maybe I won't go into the novel, but it's Jeanne d'Arval is one of the characters in the book, and she's having an affair, and it's just really beautiful in the way that it's written. But also I've started looking at some work, some of Maud's own writing, and I found an article she wrote about Black lesbian she uses Black lesbian in one word, Black lesbian characters in film, which she wrote in 1986, which is quite early. And that's really one of the only times where she actively uses that expression, or, you know, that identity about herself, which I think is really interesting, especially considering that the Le Bijou series was very much framed in the catalog as a reenactment of, or a sort of almost a queering of the idea of the muse. I'm having a lot of trouble with this. She says, Since childhood, I have served as muse to painters, poets, photographers, and musicians, sometimes unwittingly, usually with some element of collaboration. Most notably, I feature in two works in public collections, Labena Hamid's Between the Two Is My Heart Is Balanced, and Five. I didn't ask to be in these pictures. I didn't consciously sit for them, but somehow I inhabit them. It is somehow that I'm interested in when exploring notions of the muse and what it means as a woman artist to take a female subject and retrospectively what it means to serve as catalyst for ideas and representations in the work of others. I might just leave it there. I feel like I'm sort of throwing lots of information at you, but maybe we can come back to some of this in the Q&A. Thank you so much.
Thank you for four just extraordinary presentations and, you know, a tsunami of ideas and reflections on Maud Sulter. I really want us to have an opportunity to bring everyone into the conversation, so I'm just going to indulge myself in one question before we open it up. And there were lots of connections between what you were saying, I felt. And for one thing, I think three words you used, Marcia, return, remember, reclaim, sums it up for me. You know, Dion, you were talking about, you know, the importance of that relationship in a way between an older artist and a younger artist and those cycles of influence and inspiration and support. And you were talking about the Laura, about the the inspiration of Jean Duval, the way that Maud is like a detective rooting through images and evidence to kind of find, she knows these black women exist in the history, gay black women exist in the history, and she goes out to find them and reclaim them. And Evan, you spoke so beautifully about that, the importance of understanding who has come before and being an artist, knowing that there have been antecedents, that sense of lineage and connection. And I think those two elements of Carr and Safi, of resistance and remembrance, are things that also were themes in what all of you were returning and reclaiming in Maud's work. I wondered if, Evan, you could reflect first about this idea of returning and reclaiming.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess something I didn't go too deeply into for time, but, you know, for me, you know, the archival investigation has been a big part of my work and my journey in coming to know and understand, because, yeah, I did come out of my BA with a real sense of an absence, you know, like I said, of practices that really spoke to where I came from. And so, you know, in moving back to London in 2010, I was able to kind of really start to, yeah, go into the archives, you know, the Stuart Hall Library, you know, the African and Asian Visual Arts Archive at Chelsea, and, you know, a little bit later around 2013, the Making Histories Visible Archive. And, you know, that really became part of my journey to kind of understanding and redressing and remembering, you know, because I had this sense that the work was there, you know, the practices were there, but somehow they just weren't part of my arts education, you know. And so I went on that kind of, you know, that investigating, the investigatory process of trying to, yeah, figure it all out. And then that's, yeah, when collective creativity came together and we started to do that work together. And there really was something in, you know, that process being, again, a collective one. Because even, you know, yeah, being in the archive on your own and then finding these things, it's like you want somebody to be able to share that with, you know. And so, you know, in doing that work, and also as part of the process of doing that work, I was also able to build connections with, you know, a lot of the artists as well, who are very much still, you know, practicing and up to really amazing things. And so, you know, it became that process of looking back, but also being very much in the present, you know. And in that process, I was able to, you know, rather than, you know, I often come back to something Labena says, is, you know, there is no need to reinvent the wheel, you know. And actually, it was only because of all the archival work that you know, I've done and been able to build from, that I have this really great foundation, and I've had a really great foundation to build from. And, you know, I've done what I can to also kind of involve others in that process. And, you know, from then I can kind of imagine other kinds of possibilities and ways of working, and, you know, kind of working collaboratively and collectively. And yeah, I think for me, yeah, the kind of the archive has played a big part in that. And yeah,
as well, and, you know, there's a sense now that because we have the internet, you can just search and find things, and it's all there and it's all documented. But the reality is that that history is fragile and precarious.
Yes.
And
yes.
You know, it needs to be preserved, republished, brought back to the surface as a continuous struggle of remembering.
It does. And even something like, you know, with passion, you know, I would love to see it republished. You know, I would love to see
some kind
of... I
made a note of that.
Yeah, no, I mean, this is something I've been talking about for a while, because, yeah, you know, it is, you know, it does speak to a moment in time that actually there is still a lot to glean and learn from, you know. And, yeah, I've done, you know, reading groups and stuff with it, and it's really kind of impacted, you know, younger artists' practices in really big ways, you know. And so I think, yeah, also this, you know, there was also this, like you say, it's like, how do we also ensure that these, you know, these fragile kind of ephemeral documents can also kind of continue to proliferate and can also be made accessible in some way? Because, you know, archives aren't always accessible unless you have some kind of institutional affiliation. Yeah. So that's also something that, yeah, I've been, you know, kind of thinking through in my practice, is also how does the material become activated in other contexts as well?
Well, the Art 360 Foundation is working with Maud Sulter's estate to organise the archive. Yeah. And I think the idea of republishing passion is something that we need to talk to the estate about and think about how we could bring that back into circulation.
I'll just tell you that the artist Lauren Craig is looking at passion as well at the moment. I don't know if you've spoken to her, but yeah, she's working on it from at a very sort of early curatorial stage, but yeah, you should talk to her.
Dion, I wonder if you could talk as well about returning to Zabat. You mentioned it right at the end. It was quite tantalizing. I wonder if you could say a bit about what you're doing and how you're returning to Zabat and your practice.
I mean, it's in very early stages, so it's sometimes difficult to talk about work when it's not fully formed. But my work has changed. I mean, you saw a little bit of it there. But I'm now working more with abstraction. Actually, it's interesting, in the sort of British context, I'm not sure I know many other black women artists who are working. I mean, there are lots in America, you know, if you look at Mark Bradford or Maretu, or there's a certain language that's developed there that isn't echoed here. I don't know. Probably I need to do my research. But actually, in exploring abstraction, I still feel the need to anchor it in some sort of discourse with the continuum that we've been talking about. So it's always been a strange struggle, actually, for me, because even back then I was making abstract work, but actually it was almost not very cool to make abstract work then. You know, it was a bit of a no-no. It was a bit like, actually, we need to, you know, there needs to be sort of an aspect of representation. I am answering your question. It's just coming around in a circle. And
that seems appropriate.
And so, yeah, and so that sort of idea of being visible physically and the idea of figuration and being in the frame was very important then. But actually, I feel the way to speak about these things that we've been speaking about, actually, I found Marcia's work, what you spoke about, really touching in terms of this circular history and this connection with our history, which is, as you say, we've always been here. So there's no newness about it. And actually, to do that, I felt I wanted to anchor it in something that was, that had personal meaning for me, that also is an important body of work. In the way that artists do, they often look at art history to make work, you know, they respond to, you know, and so my call and response, I thought, you know, and also actually being called to this panel, interesting, it was all kind of, you know, had some synchronicity about it. I thought that made sense to look at that work, you know, a significant body of work that I was personally involved in, that I represented in, and how to now engage with that in a new language, really, which is what I'm doing. So actually, at the moment, what I'm doing is more the kind of research aspect of putting things together, like rereading that text, actually, has been really important. I found it really interesting reading it when, you know, that last bit about you read history for clues and not facts. Like, actually, the way she writes is this kind of mesh of fiction, memory. And when you know bits of it, like even just reading, like, Delta Streets one, I'm thinking, oh yeah, that's about Delta. God, what's that about? Hell no. You know, it's like, it really is a bit of a mystery. But and I think that's it's really rich, actually. But as I was saying, it's also quite spiritual, I think. I think there's something about what you've been saying that's sort of deeply spiritual, that I've realized that I, you know, the not reinventing the wheel. I don't need to reinvent the wheel. I can go to some work and carry it on in some way. That's kind of what I'm doing. I'm just, you know, and I only just started in September at the Royal College. So it's like, you know, 30 years later doing the MA that I thought I would do when I, you know. But anyway, it's feels like a good time.
Marcia, you spoke about Maud being a time traveller, and there's a strong strand in your work, and I think you were invoking it very, very powerfully in connecting with Maud's work and her legacy, of a sense of time that is far more expansive and far less delineated, I suppose, than the way in which perhaps traditional art history and traditional artistic practice sometimes thinks of time. I wonder if you could speak a little bit about that. I mean, Evan also referenced, and I think a couple of you did, spoke about how Maud referenced ancient Egypt and mythical space and time and ideas.
I suppose for me personally, it's about the absences and in trying to locate the absences. Time is completely circular, it's not linear, and I think at some point we're going to understand that and see as that. But I think Maud had that ability to understand that it was circular, and maybe in the way in which she embodied Jean Duval within herself, that was another way of encirculating time within herself. And I think for me that was quite a striking moment, that she was able to put herself in somebody else's body, but bring it to her time, and then speak to us now. And then it will speak to people continuously. And I just think that's just incredibly awesome, you know, to have that foresight and to have the ability in using photography as well, that thing that captured it captures the image, it captures the soul. Does it capture the soul? You know, it's one of the things that people were quite scared of when it first invented. Does it capture the soul? How does it transpire? How does it affect me in the future? A photograph. And I think for me, that's quite powerful.
Laura, before we open up, I wonder if you could say a little bit more about Maud's work in relation to institutions. You spoke about the Cibachrome, which of course was a like really extraordinary technology to be using at that time, and actually was hugely logistically complicated for Maud to get a hold of a camera like that to use it. But I wonder if you could say a little bit about the interface between Maud's work and institutions, because it's only really quite recently, apart from some like the Newhall Art Collection and Rochdale, actually it's quite recently that institutions have been collecting Maud's work.
Yeah. I sort of don't know where to start with that, because it's like we all know that institutions are big, slow beasts that are only just getting around to acquiring Black women's work, including, you know, the institution that I used to work for. I mean, I guess thinking about, like, the work in the V&A was acquired very early on, and I think that was interesting that she had one set that was specifically for the V&A, whereas the other set was dispersed. Yeah, I don't know. I think I'm not sure how much I have to say about that, to be honest. I mean, I did prepare an answer to your first question. You don't need to get that one.
Why don't you remember?
Well, I was just, when you were talking about, when the question that you asked Evan about how, when, I mean, it does relate to institutions, I suppose, but in a sort of a less direct way, in terms of the institution of photography and her questioning of history with a capital H and the questioning of photography and time. And I was just, I suppose, thinking about the exhibition at the National Gallery of Scotland and how she kind of refused, you know, a usual sort of group exhibition like that, you would be like, this is definitely what it's about, and this is definitely who is in all of the, you know, we know exactly who the model is, and we know exactly when it was done. But I think that the fact that she said possible appearances of Jeanne Duval, I think is really telling of the way that she thinks about history. And this idea of, like, you know, that image that I showed of Nadar, first of all, like, I was reading today in a book that it's definitely not Jeanne Duval. But then I was also reading that it... like Maud's so clear that it is from her perspective. And she says, you know, I was trying to find the quote, but she says something like, you know, go and check your archives. Why don't you know that it's her? It clearly is her. Like, and I think that's, you know, this idea of like, yes, we have always been here, but yet this really important woman to many artists, actually. I was looking also that, what's her name? Lorraine O'Grady has also made work about Jeanne Duval.
Yeah.
But yet we don't know when she was born. We're not actually sure what her job was or really much about her at all. We don't really even know what she looked like. So yeah, it's sort of like this history is there. People, you know, Black women have always been there, but where are the records? And so yeah, I don't know. I guess maybe her relationship to institutions is a sort of... it's almost like she's playing with them. It's sort of like a flirtation or something.
Well, she also set up her own gallery, so yeah. She was an institution builder as yeah. Well. We shouldn't right. Forget that.
That's true.
Let's open up. Do we have any questions in the room? Please, will you say who you are and ask if it's... Could you just hold on until the mic comes down? So I think just down here, Naomi, please, at the... Just about row three, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you to Paul Mellon. This is just a brilliant event, and My name is Judy Atiel, and I've been wanting to ask this question since Dion spoke about abstract, working with in an abstract way. And it made me think that as early as 1983, someone like Claudette Johnson was incorporating abstract elements into her work. And even though the artist still speaks about her work as being represented in a sort of figurative, there are abstract elements in the work. And I wonder whether sometimes there's certain types of language that dominates our reading of Black women's work that constantly eclipse how the work is read. So the point you make about language, I think, is really important. The way even Maud uses language to provoke different types of realities, to provoke different types of criticism around the way the record is kept and the language in which the record is kept as well. Because there is this constant invisibilizing of Black women. And it's like, we're not actually invisible. Credit is denied, and also the language excludes what we're doing. Mm-hmm. So it's all to the credit of research projects like Black Artists and Modernism that we're returning to look at the work. Mm-hmm. Because by looking at the work, old ways of speaking might not actually reveal what's going on there. Mm-hmm. So I'm really delighted, Dion, that you're working towards abstraction, because I think it's an area that's sort of denied Black female artists, because we're so overly represented within the narrative of figurative work. So thank you for that.
Yeah, it's actually just interesting when you said sort of denied. I mean, it's almost like you aren't free to do anything, although theoretically you are. You know, it's almost impossible to not somehow have some sense of responsibility or awareness where you sit. It's just not our privilege that we can enjoy it, unfortunately. But I think it's part of kind of, you know, you're kind of trying to open up a space in which everything is possible, you know. Yeah. And also, I think you have to be true to your own particular journey. Like, you can't sort of, I mean, it's not true to you to fit into whatever seems... I think, you know, we want to get out of the box, you know, and I think that that's part of the work that everyone's doing, is trying to create a space in which there's a broad kind of practice, there's a broad spectrum, everything is relevant, everything has a place. And it's just been part of, it's just, I don't know how to do figurative work at the moment, actually. It feels like there's so many traps in doing that, but also because I'm also interested in lots of other things, as we all are, you know, and I'm interested in different philosophical ideas or ideas around sort of Buddhist thought. And it's like I'm trying to bring all of those things in, but I still do have that sense of history, actually. I can't quite kind of just erase it. Yeah, not erase it, but just not speak to it, yeah.
But it's important, I think, the point you're making, which is that sometimes the way in which institutions frame work, in which invitations are issued or contexts are drawn, that become the constraint.
Yeah.
It's not about what artists themselves are doing, because there's such a breadth and complexity of language and modes of articulating. Do we have another question in the room? Yes, one at the back. And then, do we have any questions online? One. Okay, so I think we've got time just for two. The question at the back there, and then we'll take the question online.
Thank you so much.
Could you say who you are?
Hi, my name is Sophia Gotti. Do I need to say more? No. Hi. I'm really inspired by what I listened to this evening, so thank you so much. Also for sharing your emotions, because I feel like that has a real place. One of the things I work on a lot is archives, and trying to think about what happens to the archive, to this documentation. First of all, when the archive doesn't have any documentation that you're looking for, maybe, or when the archive then becomes part of an institution, does it not lose so many of its creative spaces, attributes? And when you're talking about reclaiming, repurposing, reconfiguring, I was wondering what you're in that, with that intent, what is your relationship with archival material or that idea? A very open question to anyone who would like to answer, actually.
Who'd like to take that question? Evan or Marcia?
Yeah, I mean, I've spoken to it a little bit, but yeah, I mean, you know, I think for me, it's kind of what I said, you know, that actually I've, you know, having done, you know, a lot of different, you know, explored, you know, a lot of different archives and a lot of different contexts, you know, something I have realized is that even when the material, you know, the tiny amount of material is there, it can be very hard to access, you know, because of the bureaucratic processes you have to go to in order to do so. Either you need an institutional affiliation, or, you know, you have to submit some kind of documents, or, you know, whatever. And, you know, for various reasons, I've been able to do that, but I understand that that's not always possible. You know, so I think something that I'm interested in is, you know, how does the material become activated in other ways? And, you know, I have tried to do it in different ways by, you know, organizing, you know, some reading groups and, you know, collective creativity. A lot of our work was about, yeah, holding space for people to be able to, like, interact with material without having to go through those various, you know, hoops. Because, you know, the reality is that, you know, a lot of the material isn't part of people's arts education. You know, I also teach, you know, and I encounter that a lot, you know, where students are like, oh, but where is the material? And yeah, you know, you can find bits and pieces of it online, but often it's decontextualized and, you know, miscredited or, you know, poorly credited and things like that. You don't really get a sense of actually the, you know, the dialogue and the relationships that people had, you know, the connections they had. You know, you really only get to understand that when you do the archival work, you know. And so, you know, I don't have an answer, but it's something that I'm really interested in. You know, how does an archive become more active? You know, how does it become something that people can really be with, like, outside of the bureaucratic processes, you know, that can kind of enable you to really kind of access that material?
Okay. I think maybe I have one thing to say about that question. Oh, do you want
very quickly, because we're running out of time.
I went on a bit.
Go for it, Laura. I was just going to talk a little bit how Maud, you worked with archives. Yeah. Because I was just thinking about how it's almost like, you know, this idea of going into an archive and sort of looking at material and looking for facts. It's almost like she did the opposite of that, in the way that she took on this persona and kind of made stuff up and lived this person. And I feel like I want to ask Dion to tell the story, but you told me that Maud shaved her head to make Zabat, well, to make Calliope.
it was more about that I was so impressed by her strength of character. Mm. After photographing that piece of her as Jeanne Duval, she had this amazing head of hair. You could see it there, that's her hair. And then she came in the next morning and she shaved her head. And, you know, I was like, that's bold. It was more just the boldness of her ability to go from that incredible, you know, let's get you all wrapped up in this and lit and then that, you know, and then to come in, besides the fact that this whole thing about all the aunties in your head saying, why have you cut your hair? Apart from that story, it was just her decisiveness, you know. Yeah.
And the reason I brought that up is because, I'm doing what Maud does and making something up, but I know that Jeanne Duval, she apparently sold her jewels and her hair in order to keep her and Baudelaire alive, afloat financially, because he was sort of financially, I don't know, he just threw his money around, basically. And I just thought that was really, like, I wonder if that was some sort of, like, homage or... Yeah.
Okay, we have one last question.
Yeah, it's more of a comment, actually, from Nina Edge, who is watching. So I just thought it'd be really important to... So thank you, Nina, for commenting virtually. And they said that, you know, the copy of Passion still speaks to audiences, which is my essay in the book, feels dated. And just wondering whether images and words time travel differently. So maybe that's just something for us to ponder about, the different modes of text and image and their interaction in publications and their afterlives afterwards.
Nina Edge, another important artists, which who we
it's
should
on the front cover, right?
credit and whose work is needs to be seen more often. Evan, thank you so much. Marcia, Laura, Dion, it's been an absolute pleasure. And thank you to the Paul Mellon Centre and Murray Edwards College. This has been a really important conversation. And most importantly, thank you to all of you who are in this room and virtually with us this evening. It was an absolute pleasure to be with you.